Notice. I called Alexis Williams, Politico's director of events, over the 4th of July weekend, and I said, this may be a crazy idea, but what if? And she said, let's do it. So thank you all for being here. Standing room only, Playbook Cocktails. Here on the stage, we have a conservative Republican, a progressive Democrat. Senator Booker,
do they offer you cocktails?
I think cocktails, but I didn't.
So I won't tell what's in it. Senator Booker, tell us behind the scenes. How did this bromance happen? I understand that, like a lot of people, you courted on the internet and you were brought together.
I do have to say that I am long since recognized the great American holiday of Festivus. I happened to see that Rand Paul was listing his grievances. And you have a long list of grievances, sir.
Yes.
One of them was that I did not tweet him enough.
Wait, I can't believe you didn't tweet anybody
enough. Yeah, that is hard to
believe. You certainly didn't complain that you didn't Instagram enough.
No. But look, in my election I talked about, to get down here, I actually brought up Rand Paul often when people talked about the problems in Washington. I said, look, there's so much in the areas on tough problems where we can find things to work on. I would bring him up as somebody that I have a lot of agreement in the space of criminal justice reform. I was sworn in on Halloween, that other auspicious holiday like Festivus, and one of the first people to come over to me and congratulate me was Rand Paul, and that was, I think, the first time we mentioned the issue. And again, as I said, he and others had already been working on the issue. I asked, we could do some things together.
But I just remember the first time I really met you, you were tweeting, and it was in the green room of like NBC in New York, and couldn't get a word in edgewise because he was busy tweeting.
I was, hey, check it out, I'm in the green room with Rand Paul.
I'm just wondering if we can get a reality show and whether ethics will allow us to collect any compensation.
We're both a little camera shy now. So, Senator Paul, this week you both introduced the Redeem Act. This is, as I understand it, just to spell it out, the Redeem Act, which is the record expungement designed to enhance employment. And the way I understand that is, if you were a young person who got caught with pot brownies, you don't want to make it so you can never get a job.
Yeah, you know what I've found as I've been around Kentucky and met people is that I meet people who have trouble still getting a job because of their felony record sometimes. And many of these are nonviolent felonies. And I think really, you serve your time, you should get a second chance. And so to me, it's a lot about trying to get people back into society, back into employment. And I think this is great. It's been, Cory and I both have had great ideas for it, and I think the bill's turned out, I think it'll be a good success when we get through.
And Senator Paul, yesterday you talked to President Obama about the Redeem Act. How did that go?
He's interested, and I've also met with Eric Holder as well on these issues. And frankly, I complimented him on some of the pardons that he's done for people who have been in jail 10, 15, 20 years for crack cocaine, whereas if it had been powder cocaine, they either never went to jail or went to jail for 6 months or a year. And really, there still is some disparity there, and I think he's aware of it, but I complimented him on that because I think a lot of times we Republicans aren't complimenting the president very often. Instead, when I can, and it is an issue where I think both parties can come together and work on an issue.
Senator Cory Booker, would you say that the current drug laws are racist or just incoherent?
Well, Senator Paul says a little about Barack Obama, great president or greatest president? Look. We have a serious, serious crisis in this country that we are only 4 to 5% of the globe's population, but we incarcerate 25% of the globe's prison population. It'd be one thing if there were all people going out there with violent crimes and sticking people up, but 72% about of those people are nonviolent criminals. And we've had an explosion of the prison population since the so-called war on drugs started, but since about the 70s, you've seen, in fact, there are more people today in jail for nonviolent drug offenses than all the people in prison in 1975. And so we have a serious problem that's costing taxpayers billions, in fact, $250 billion a year. We're grossly spending to take away people's liberty that ultimately what we could be doing is empowering them to be successful. So look, you know, I just got to the Senate in October, And people like Senator Rand Paul, Senator Mike Lee, Senator Leahy, Senator Durbin, a lot of folks were already starting to say in a growing bipartisan chorus, enough is enough. We could be saving money, empowering people to succeed, and ending something that really betrays American values, fiscal prudency and liberty.
Senator Paul, did President Obama commit to push for this? Did he commit to pushing Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid to take it up?
I don't know if I want to go that far. He's supportive of the concept, I think I can say that. And I think he will help. He indicated that he wanted to bring some of the sponsors of these bills to the White House to talk more about them. But publicly, I think he's been very supportive of criminal justice reform. And I think of people on both sides of the aisle. Cory mentioned Senator Lee as well from Utah, who's been doing this. He and Durbin have a bill on mandatory minimums, where sometimes you commit a crime and the judge has no discretion. And often these federal judges are writing opinions saying, I'm horrified by putting this young man in prison for 10 years or 15 years, sometimes 55 years, for sale of marijuana. And I sort of halfway jokingly say, in Kentucky, you can kill somebody and be eligible for parole in 12 years, but you can sell marijuana and go to jail for 50 years. So we really have to fix this problem.
And we have thousands of Americans right now being denied opportunities to work because they're checking a box because they got caught for smoking pot. They got caught for possession of drugs. Nonviolent offenses. And what I want to do is stop that cycle that's undermining our financial security as a nation, stealing the liberty, undermining the liberty of millions of people. And the fact that you have two people of such difference sitting here today to talk about a problem that is not popular. If Brandon, you and I polled this issue, would this be a big issue? No.
Well, no, I think it's growing, though. I think the public has changed.
It's growing if we can get the press to focus on this. to what the president is.
You know, the next question should be, will you, Senator Booker, will you go to the border and talk about criminal justice?
At some point, this game of ping pong back and forth, who's up, who's down, has got to stop. We've got to get talking about, are we going to lead this globe again, and what matters? But there is a lot of space in the Senate, from talking to people on both sides of the aisle, for us to begin to get back to the business that America sent us down to. And fundamental to that is this idea of equal opportunity. So we've got to figure out ways to come together as one.
I think the overwhelming issue of the last year and maybe of the next year that we have to figure out in an age where you've got people like Senator Booker who are tweeting all the time, he deserves to have, you don't have any privacy in your tweets, do you? Anyway, you do deserve that privacy in your communications with people. And the Supreme Court recently with the 9-0 ruling saying that your cell phone can't be looked at with a warrant is a huge step forward and a huge forward for appropriate.
Okay.